What is going on, everyone? This is Eric coming at you from just outside of Hartford, Connecticut. And today, we're going to continue our week of the Black Sox and the Black Sox scandal. And this will be a different type of bio. Now, we have gone over who the players were that were involved in the scandal. We've discussed the scandal itself. But today's video will see us discuss the man who stepped up and essentially made a move. So, right off the bat, we're going to be discussing the first commissioner of Major League Baseball, Kenesaw Mountain Landis. Now, full disclosure too, we will be discussing his law career before we discuss his role as commissioner in baseball. So, of course, there will be a timestamp in the description below. If you don't care about what he did before baseball, definitely feel free to skip that. It's not the most important thing in the world. It just gives us some background on his character as a person. So, Kenesaw Mountain Landis was born on November 20th, 1866, in Millville, Ohio. Now, interestingly enough, Kenesaw was named after a Civil War battle. His father had fought for the Union, and he was wounded at the Battle of Kenesaw Mountain. Now, his two parents were undecided, they were unable to choose a name, so his mother suggested the name Kenesaw Mountain for the couple's sixth child. Now, Kenesaw's family was very well known and respected. His father was a doctor, and two of his brothers, Charles and Frederick, would both go on to become congressmen for the U.S. So, yeah. So, the bar was very high for Kenesaw right off the bat. Now, his father would purchase a few farms after his war injury forced him to kind of scale back on the medical business. He couldn't travel around as much as he used to be able to. So, as a result, Kenesaw spent most of his youth working on the farm. In 1883, at the age of 17, Kenesaw became an official court reporter. Now, that is essentially the person who writes down what happened in the court. So, you know, the person who types up the notes, who writes down the scribble and goes, okay, hey, yeah, this is the person said that they were did not see the person exactly in question at this particular time, but they saw the person show up about 20 minutes later. So, you know, something like that. So this was his first taste of the courtroom. And in 1886, Landis supported a friend who was running for the Indiana Secretary of State. Now, his friend would go on to win this position. And as a result for his loyalty, Kenesaw was rewarded with a job in the Indiana Department of State. So, after a couple years, he would apply for and would become an attorney. Now, after a tough time finding clients, as he didn't have an official degree, at the time he didn't need a degree in Indiana, he decided to go to Cincinnati's YMCA Law School for a year. And then he spent another year at Union Law School, which is now a part of Northwestern. Now, after graduating, he spent a couple years in a small practice in Chicago. This was his own practice. Now, in 1893, Landis was hired by the U.S. Secretary of War, Walter Q. Gresham. Landis would serve as Gresham's personal secretary for 2 years before Gresham would pass away. Now, interestingly enough, President Grover Cleveland noticed Kenesaw Mountain Landis, and he offered him the role of ambassador, U.S. ambassador to Venezuela. But Landis would decline, and he would return to Chicago to focus on law again. So, from there, he would marry Winifred Reed. The couple would have two children, one of whom, Reed, would become a very decorated military pilot, and eventually would become an ace, as he fought in both World War I and World War II. Now, from 1895 until 1904, Landis ran a successful corporate law practice in Chicago. His success led to his involvement in politics. Now, he would serve as a campaign manager for a friend of his, Frank Loudon's bid for Illinois governor in 1904. Now, Loudon did lose, but he caught the attention of Theodore Roosevelt, who was president of the United States at the time. Roosevelt would offer Loudon a role as judge on the U.S. District Court of Northern Illinois. Now, he would decline, but he recommended Kenesaw for the position. Roosevelt was kind of like, huh, that's interesting. He did a little more research, and he said that's a good idea. So he would nominate Landis for the role, and he was approved on March 18th, 1905. Now, Kenesaw had been a corporate lawyer leading up to his appointment on the bench, but he quickly proved to be a fair, unbiased judge who didn't necessarily stand up for corporate law anymore. He would do what he thought was the right move. So, he was known as a character in the courtroom, but the people loved him. Now, one of the big cases that he was a part of was versus Standard Oil. So, in 1907, Landis would impose a $29 million fine on Standard Oil. Now, citizens were extremely excited about this. They're like, oh, cool, someone's, you know, finally going to the trusts. You know, we're sick of these trusts everywhere. Standard Oil is ruining everything. But unfortunately, did it work out? We'll see. So a quote that came out was, much of the nation could hardly believe a federal judge had finally cracked down on a trust and cracked down hard. That was in a newspaper article at the time. So for the record, Theodore Roosevelt called the decision bully. As you know, Theodore Roosevelt always said bully. So he also noted that, quote, Judge Landis will be dead a long time before this fine is paid, end quote. Unfortunately, he was right, as the fine was never paid after Standard Oil appealed the decision and they would win. Now, Kenesaw was a huge baseball fan, of course, growing up in the Chicago area. He was near Chicago for a good chunk of his time. He had the ability to see both the White Sox and the Cubs. And at this point in time, those were two of the best teams in baseball. So in 1915, a case was brought to him. Now, the newly founded Federal League was suing the National and American Leagues. The Federal League called the AL and NL leagues trusts and sought to have them disbanded under the Sherman Act, which was against trusts. So a trust is basically a big buildup of organizations that, you know, dominate a particular fact, you know, faucet of life. And, Theodore Roosevelt hated them. I don't want to go too much into history here, but Theodore Roosevelt hated the trusts. That's why he hated Standard Oil. He hated all these big companies. So you have to wonder what would happen nowadays with some, you know, corporations like Amazon being what they are. Anyway, the American League and the National League did fear that Landis would strike down the reserve clause, which was a very unpopular clause in baseball that made it so only players could sign, that players could only sign a new contract with their former teams. So there was no free agency. And they also feared that he would take down the 10-day clause, which allowed teams, but not players, to terminate a contract on 10 days' notice. So in other words, hey, we're getting rid of you after 10 days. But a player couldn't do the same thing. The team could do that to him, though. Now, after hearing both sides of this case between the Federal League and the American and National Leagues, Kenesaw kept the public waiting and waiting. Now, eventually, after months of waiting, the two sides would settle out of court, and the Federal League would disband as a result. Now, many believe that Kenesaw was going to rule against the American and National Leagues, but he couldn't bring it to, you know, he couldn't do it because he loved both leagues. He loved watching his Chicago teams play. So he kind of tried to hold it off as long as he could, hope they would settle out of court. It happened. So, yeah, just during the trial, he would even say, quote, both sides must understand that any blows at this thing called baseball would be regarded by this court as a blow to the national institution, end quote. So Kenesaw would actually consider leaving his role on the bench to return to a private practice, but he would change his mind after the U.S. got involved in World War I in 1917. Landis, then 50, asked the U.S. Secretary of War if he could enlist and fight overseas in France. He was denied, but was urged to make pro-war speeches. Kenesaw agreed. Now, he was very, very hard on draft dodgers. He hated draft dodgers. So he presided over the trials of 120 men who dodged the draft. Most of them were either foreign-born, socialists, or both. So Kenesaw was not lenient to these men, as he would sentence all but three of them to maximum sentence of 1 year and 1 day in jail. 37 of these men were actually ordered to be deported after their sentences were up. Landis served as the judge in another major case, which saw the Industrial Workers of the World, a union that had actively encouraged its members to oppose the draft, on trial against the U.S. government. Now, it was a massive case, and Landis let a few of the defendants off the hook after they would enlist. So one of the, you know, you would enlist in the war, you would go to the trial, and you'd be like, hey, Mr. Judge, I'm wearing, you know, I enlisted, here's my proof that I enlisted, I'm going overseas in a month, and he would let you off the hook. Now, the remaining men were given harsh punishments, as Landis saw fit. One of the bosses of this case, or one of the big people in this union, was Big Bill Hayward. Now, he would be released on trial, and then he would flee the United States for the newly founded USSR. This upset Kenesaw greatly, but it is what it is. He would eventually refer to the defendants of this case as scum, filth, and slimy rats. He was not happy with these draft dodgers. Now, Kenesaw would take on a few more big-name cases about World War I draft dodgers, but we're not going to go into every single one of them. Now, he would resign his post as a federal judge in February of 1922. Now, this was because he'd become commissioner of baseball up to that point. Wait, what? Yeah, that's what happened. So, that's the end of his law practice. So right now, the 10-minute mark is right where we start discussing his baseball career. Timestamp was in the description below. So up to this point, the 1919 World Series was believed to have been fixed. We have discussed this. So this World Series and the Black Sox as a whole will get their own video. Of course, they did. So real briefly here, at this time, a lot of people kind of were fixing baseball games. The baseball athletes weren't getting paid nearly what they get paid today, even when you adjust for inflation. Like, the players would be lucky if they got $1,000 on the year. And a lot of people would kind of, you know, if you were on an iffy team, you would kind of go to a good team. Like, let's just say you're playing for the Phillies and you're playing the Cubs. The Cubs are a win away from clinching the pennant. You would go to them and you would say, hey, listen, I'm willing to swing at anything you throw to me if you slip me $50. This was common practice back in the day. Now, it's believed that the 1919 World Series saw this happen. Now, the White Sox owner, Charles Kaminsky, was a very, very cheap owner. So he didn't pay his players what they saw fit. He would promise them contract negotiations in the future and go out of his way to screw them over, like we saw with Eddie Sakat. So it's just, that's what would happen. And as a result, it's believed that 8 players on this team, 7 players if you want to get into it, were well aware of this, and they decided to team up together to throw the 1919 World Series against the Cincinnati Reds. Now, we're not going to get into Shoeless Joe Jackson right now in this video. We're not going to get into Buck Weaver. But the other 6 players are all definitely up for debate. So, yeah. That was a real brief history of what the 1919 World Series was, which saw the Reds were not favored at all. The White Sox were heavily favored, but they would lose that World Series 5-3. So, yeah, gamblers made a lot of money from the Reds winning. So, yeah. Anyway, on September 28th, 1920, 7 players who were still on the White Sox were indicted, and the White Sox would lose out on the AL pennant. They were all, you know, once the news came out of this, they kind of pulled them all, and they said, all right, you're not going to play. You're suspended for the time being. Kaminsky was pissed off at them all. So at this point, it was clear that baseball had a problem. Now, it was at this point in time, the league was run by a 3-man committee known as the National Commission. This group consisted of the American League president, the National League president, and the owner of the Reds. He had kind of come up there. He had been such a big name in baseball up to this point that they gave him the role. All the other owners were fine with it. Now, this led to some problems where the National League would win some decisions against the American League. The American League would win a few decisions over the National League, but it would almost always come down to what the Reds owner wanted, just because that's how it was. So around 1920, the Reds owner said, all right, I don't like this role, I'm done, and he would step down. Now, this would lead to a 2-man deadlock on most decisions. Many of the owners in the league wanted this to come to an end. They're like, this is ridiculous, everything's coming to a 1-1 tie, nothing's getting done. So the National League president advocated for a new national commission consisting of 3 people who were not tied to baseball in any way, shape, or form. He stated, quote, we want a man as chairman who will rule with an iron hand, .. Baseball has lacked a hand like that for years. It needs it now worse than ever. Therefore, it is our object to appoint a big man to lead a new commission, end quote. They were looking for change. Now, on November 8th, 1920, 11 of the 16 owners for Major League Baseball, now this was all 8 National League teams, and the Yankees, White Sox, and Red Sox, all met, and they decided that they wanted Kenesaw Mountain Landis to be the leader of this new committee. They eventually decided that he, and he alone, would be the lone commissioner member. He was the only one. Now, this was also because Kenesaw said, I don't want anyone here. I want to make all the decisions myself. Thus, Kenesaw Mountain Landis was appointed the commissioner of baseball. No secondary people, just Kenesaw. And he couldn't be happier about it. So Landis would obviously accept this role, and he would get a salary of $50,000 annually. And he was also granted the ability to rule with an iron fist. What he said was law. You were not going to be able to go up against him. If he said, you lose this game, your field was unplayable, you lost, give it up, you had to accept it. You had to call it a day. You had to say, yes, sir, sorry for wasting your time, sir. So the owners were not allowed to publicly criticize him. If Landis found out that you went out and said, yeah, this Kenesaw guy's a moron, he could fire you. He could get rid of you. He could force you to sell your team. Kenesaw could also not be fired. He had absolute power over anyone and everyone involved in the sport, from the bat boys to the owners. If you were involved in Major League Baseball, he had control over you. He was also allowed to ban people from the sport for life. Now back to the Black Sox. The Black Sox trial was a mess. Evidence was constantly disappearing from courtrooms and charges were being dismissed as the evidence was lost. As a result, Landis created an ineligible list and placed all players being investigated on said list. Now this stopped them from playing minor or Major League Baseball. Now they could still play in leagues that weren't affiliated with Major League Baseball, but you weren't going to get much money doing that. So the criminal trial of the Black Sox ended with a victory for the players. The players and fans in attendance broke into a celebration when the jury returned with a not guilty verdict for all players involved. The celebration was short-lived, however. Kenesaw Mountain Landis stated, and this is his most famous quote, "Regardless of the verdict of juries, no player that throws a ball game, no player that undertakes or promises to throw a ball game, no player that sits in a conference with a bunch of crooked players and gamblers where the ways and means of throwing ball games are planned and discussed and does not promptly tell his club about it will ever play professional baseball again." So he also said, "Of course, I don't know that any of these men will apply for reinstatement, but if they do, the above are at least a few of the rules that will be enforced. Just keep in mind that, regardless of the verdict of juries, baseball is competent to protect itself against crooks, both inside and outside the game." End quote. Yes, what that did is that effectively banned 9 players from the Black Sox scandal, as there was one player who actually bet money on the series because he knew about it, who played on another team, plus the 8 players who were involved. This also excluded Buck Weaver. This is a very hot topic. Even today, people still think Buck Weaver should be freed. So, Shulisto Jackson, of course, same thing. So, this was the end of all these players' involvement in professional baseball, and it proved that Landis was here to stay. He helped to fix Major League Baseball's tarnished reputation. Now, this decision is what Kenesaw Mountain Landis is by far most known for in his life. Now, he would crack down on any and all forms of gambling in baseball. 2 players were rumored to be involved in the gambling aspect in 1919. One of the World Series, and then, you know, of course, there was a regular season game. Both players were banned. Another 2 cases came up to Landis. A New York Giants pitcher, who was upset at his owner for disciplining him for drinking, wrote a letter to another player suggesting that he would take a bribe to ensure his team would not win the pennant. And later on, a Giants hitter who offered a bribe to a Phillies player to, quote, take it easy, end quote, on the Giants. Landis got whiff of both, banned them both instantly. There were also a pair of owners that were banned for betting on the league, betting on games. So players were terrified that they would become the next Buck Weaver. So they would all start to tell on one another. You know, oh, even if you were joking around and said, hey, I'll pay you $50 to strike out. I'll pay you $1 to strike out. They would run and tell their owner, and then their owner would, of course, contact Kenesaw Mountain Landis and say, hey, my player just said that this guy did this. So now, an interesting story between Kenesaw Mountain Landis and Yankees legend Babe Ruth came to attention to me. So they had a disagreement on barnstorming. So the rule was that players whose teams had played in the World Series were not allowed to barnstorm. After the 1921 season, Babe Ruth and 3 other Yankees players went on a barnstorming trip. Now, barnstorming is essentially you would go around, travel around the country, play a couple ball games against lesser-known teams, and you'd get paid handsomely for it. You'd get paid, let's just say, $200 to go down to, for example, Hartford, and you'd play up against a team like the Firemen in Hartford, and you'd get paid good money, or you'd play against Hartford's minor league club or something like that. Now, Landis was not happy that they had broken the rules, and he had talked to Babe Ruth about it as well. He had said, hey, Babe, I don't want you to do this. Now, they got really mad, and as a result, you know, Ruth and his players just went on anyway. Landis said, all right, you want to break the rules? That's fine. You cannot play at any Major League Baseball parks. You cannot play at any minor league baseball parks. So that left them with real garbage ballparks to play at. The trip ended horribly, and the tour was canceled early. Now, Ruth and the other Yankees players were suspended for just over a month for this. Landis was also known for his role in the minor league systems of baseball. Now, he did not allow teams to own multiple teams, so he did not allow a parent club to own multiple minor league teams in the same league. Why? Well, there was a rule in place at this time that allowed minor league teams to keep a player on their roster for 2 years. So basically, let's just say you had a lead, you had a team in AAA. So you could put someone like Joe DiMaggio, for example, on that minor league team and keep him there for 2 years, and then you had to call him up. If you kept him there after the 2 years, a draft came into place and any team could pick him. So what they would do is they would stow someone like Joe DiMaggio on their minor league team based in, let's just say, New York City. And then after 2 years, if he still needed development, they would pick him from their minor league team based in, say, Philadelphia. And then all of a sudden, you have Joe DiMaggio still. He's just playing on another team of yours, and he gets another 2 years for you. So some teams, namely the St. Louis Cardinals, were known perpetrators of this. They had so many minor league teams, so many minor league affiliates that they owned, and they would do this constantly. So this, of course, would really upset Kenesaw, because even if they didn't draft the players, they would just trade them for dummies. So it would be like, all right, we'll trade you Joe DiMaggio for Willie Mays. Okay, that sounds great. And then you just swap them after a year and a half, then you get another 2 years of each of control for each. So Landis would force teams to release players if he found out that this was happening. Now, the biggest example of this occurred in 1938 when he released 70 players from the Cardinals prospect pool. Now, this was probably the just very surprising. He tried to crack down. It worked. It did stop it from happening. And he forced you to acknowledge any team that you owned, you had to publicly say, we own this team. This is our affiliate. And if anyone saw anything crazy, they would speak out about it. They would say, hey, I think the Cardinals own three affiliates here. And then Landis would investigate. Now, the most controversial aspect of Landis' reign as commissioner came in the form of race relations. So Landis never actively stated that he was a, you know, pro-segregation of Major League Baseball, but he also never did anything to encourage the league to add African-American talent. He also stepped in and ordered that a game between the Negro League's Kansas City Monarchs and the Caucasian Dizzy Dean's All-Stars to be canceled. Now, a lot of people think this is because the Monarchs had beaten the All-Stars in a couple of games prior. Yeah. He also claimed, you know, that this was because that event between the Monarchs and the All-Stars was outselling Major League Baseball games. But many believed this to be the fact that the Monarchs had won the previous three games. And Landis said, all right, but we will never know. Now, writer Rob Nayer stated, quote, Landis has been blamed for delaying the integration of the major leagues, but the truth is that the owners didn't want black players in the majors any more than Landis did. It's not that likely that, even if Landis hadn't died in 1944, he could have prevented Branch Rickey from bringing Jackie Robinson to the National League in 1947. End quote. So, Bill Veeck, a man who will get his own bio in the future, don't worry, he's a very interesting person, he was apparently in line to purchase the Phillies in 1943. Now, he allegedly called Kenesaw about the sale, and he told him that he planned to stock the Phillies farm system with African-American talent. However, Landis was shocked and appalled, and he pressured the National League to step in and not sell the team to Veeck. So, this story has no evidence other than Veeck's own words in his autobiography. Landis was never, he passed away before hearing about it, or before he could say anything. So, it's a bunch of hearsay. We have no idea if it actually happened or not. Just something that was worth noting. So Landis was involved in many other innovations in baseball. Now, Landis had a lot of power in the World Series. After Game 2 of the 1922 World Series was called a tie due to darkness, Landis decided to move the start time for all future World Series games up to avoid this from happening again. Now, Landis also seemed to hate the idea of playing baseball at night. He despised it. As the 1930s would progress, Kenesaw did anything he could to limit the amount of games played at night. In 1933, the All-Star Game, an idea that was beloved by Landis, began. Now, this year also saw Landis implement a rule that stated only he could throw a player out of a World Series game. In 1934, this would happen when Landis pulled Cardinal Joe Medwick, who was being pelted with fruit after fighting with a member of the opposing Tigers. This game was in Detroit. Now, this happened because it was Game 7. The Cardinals were winning 9-0. So really, Medwick had no real power to stay in the game. There was no point in keeping him in the game. His health was at risk. So in 1938, an umpire would suffer facial injuries after taking a wild pitch to the face. This led to Landis mandating that six umpires were present at all World Series games. Just in case something were to happen, they'd have someone who could step in. So in 1941, the United States would enter World War II. Landis wrote then-President Franklin Delano Roosevelt about the war in baseball. FDR asked Landis to keep the sport running as he viewed baseball as important for morale. Landis would agree. Now, Landis also promised to keep the sport going. He said, quote, "We'll play as long as we can put nine men on the field, end quote. In 1943, like I said before, Landis banned Phillies owner William D. Cox from baseball after he was caught betting on his own team. Now, this was one of the last major things that Kenesaw did. In October of 1944, Landis checked into a hospital with a severe cold. While at the hospital, he would suffer a heart attack. Now, he remained alert for a while, and he continued his duties as commissioner to the best of his abilities. However, on November 25th, 1944, Kenesaw Mountain Landis passed away. Now, he was elected to the Cooperstown Hall of Fame shortly after his death. So, Kenesaw Mountain Landis was a very successful lawyer, but his impact will always be felt in the sport of baseball. He served as the league's first commissioner, and he took a hard stance against gambling. This is a rule that is still in effect today, as we know with players like Pete Rose. So his spot in the Hall of Fame is deserved. As without Landis, who knows if we would even have the sport known as baseball to this day. Now, I would like to end this biography with lyrics to the song Kenesaw Mountain Landis by John Colton. He didn't do that much, except he saved the game of baseball. ... Now, the treachery of Shoeless Joe can't hurt us anymore, and it'll always be remembered as Kenesaw Mountain Landis. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I hope you guys are enjoying Black Sox Week. That was the bio of Kenesaw Mountain Landis. Like I said, timestamps are in the description below. If you don't want to hear about his law trials, you know, his law career, please feel free to skip. Hope you guys enjoyed this, though. That was Kenesaw Mountain Landis. Have a great rest of your day.